See, one of the central notions in linear algebra is that of a linear transformation. This is also central not only linear algebra but the entire mathematics. So today I will discuss the notion of linear transformation, give several examples. Now these examples will justify the statement that I made just now. You will see that linear transformations arise in differential equations, in integral calculus, in matrices, for transformations between vector spaces, etc. So let's first look at the notion of a linear transformation, look at several examples, and probably towards the end of the class we will look at some properties, some simple properties, some not so simple properties, and then we will be able to compare how a linear transformation behaves with a general function between vector spaces. Okay, so let's begin with the notion of a linear transformation between two vector spaces. So I have two vector spaces, let us call T as a linear transformation. Now what this means is that V and W are vector spaces, T is a function to begin with. So I am just emphasizing, it is a function that satisfies the following two conditions. T of u plus v equals T of u plus T of v for all u v in v, and T of alpha u equals alpha T of u. This is true for all alpha in the underlying field, which we are assuming is a real field, and for all u in V. Okay. So a linear transformation is a function. A linear transformation between two vector spaces is a function between those two vector spaces that must satisfy these two conditions. Let us observe that the right hand side vector is in W. Okay. What is inside U plus V? That is in V, T of that is in W, and the formula for T of U plus V is given by this. The formula for T of alpha U is given by this right hand side. Okay. Sometimes we write T U instead of T of U. It is just a notational convenience. So let us now look at examples. Let us dispose of the trivial examples. First one, you look at the map which I will denote by 0, 0 from V to W defined by 0 of u is 0 for all u in v. See, the left hand side 0 or o is a 0 transformation, the right hand side 0 is a 0 vector in w. Okay. Trivially this is a linear transformation because it satisfies these two conditions. Okay. This is called the 0 transformation. Example 2, I will call it I from V to V. You know what it is, the identity transformation defined by I of U equals U for all U in V. Now you see that the right hand side U is the same as the left hand side U that you started with. So you need W to be equal to V for identity transformation, W is equal to V. So these two are trivial examples of linear transformations. Let us now look at one non-trivial example, and then probably two examples from geometry, motivated by notions from geometry. So let me first look at a non-trivial linear transformation. Let us say T from R2 to R3 t from R2 to R3 is defined by t of something. Okay, so t of x1 x2, a typical element in R2 is x1 x2, t of that element, let us say the right hand side is x1 x2 x1 minus x2, and I need to remember that x comes from R2. T of x1 x2 is the first component is x1, second component x2, third component x1 minus x2. So what you observe is that this x1 x2 belongs to R2, this belongs to R3. This is linear. Let me first take this as the first example and then verify these two conditions, that this is a linear transformation. We need to verify first condition. So let us take xy in R2, and the notation that I will use is x equals x1 x2, y equals y1 y2. I must verify that t of x plus y equals tx plus ty first. Okay. Look at t of x plus y. This is t of the vector x plus y, I know is coordinate wise, x1 plus y1, x2 plus y2. I will call this as t of z1 comma z2, where z1 is x1 plus y1, z2 is x2 plus y2. So I have t of two coordinates, I have the formula there. So this is z1, z2, z1 minus z2, that is the definition. T of x1, x2 is x1, x2, then x1 minus x2. So t of z2, z1, z2, z1 minus z2, z1 is x1 plus y1, z2 is x2 plus y2, z1 minus z2 is, I will write it as x1 minus x2 plus y1 minus y2. I can write this as x1 x2, x1 minus x2 plus y1 y2, y1 minus y2. This is addition in R3, this is the operation plus in R3. The first term now is tx, the second term is ty. Okay, so tx plus y is tx plus ty. We can also verify t of alpha x equal to alpha tx. Let us do that quickly. T of alpha x is t of alpha into x1 x2, that is t of alpha x1 comma alpha x2, which by definition is alpha x1 minus, sorry, alpha x1 alpha x2 alpha x1 minus alpha x2, which let me write as alpha times x1 x2 x1 minus x2, which is alpha tx. Okay, so this is a simple verification that T is a linear transformation. Okay, the T that defined that's defined here is a linear transformation. Okay, let's look at other examples. Let me now look at two examples coming from geometry. Look at the transformation that sends a vector in R2 on the plane. I have a transformation which sends a vector x to a vector obtained by reflecting with respect to the horizontal axis. That is example 4. You tell me if this is what I am talking about. T of x1 x2 is x1 minus x2. This is the transformation which takes the vector x1 x2 to x1 minus x2, so it is reflection with respect to the horizontal axis. Okay, if you think of R2 as a horizontal and a vertical, then this is what it does. Let's say x1, x2. Then if x1, x2 is here, okay, let's say xy, and I'll call this a general point x1, x2. Then it must go to this point, which is a reflection of this. This is x1 minus x2. Okay. I could have written x1 minus x2 here, x1, x2 here, but doesn't matter. Reflection. This is an example of a linear transformation. I am not going to verify that it satisfies those two defining equations. This T is linear. Okay. This comes from geometry, reflection. Example 5, rotation. Okay, let me call it T is a reflection. A reflection with respect to some axis, I have taken the horizontal axis. 5 is rotation. Rotation, let's first derive the formula and then get the transformation from that formula. Rotation means the following. I am again in R2. I have a vector here at a distance r from the origin, and I'll call that x1, x2. This makes an angle. So this is r for me. This makes an angle, let's say alpha, with the horizontal axis, positive x-axis. I am rotating this. When you rotate, this length does not change. The distance from the origin doesn't change by rotation. So let's say I have something like this here. This is my y, and I write y as y1, comma y2. The rotation is by an angle theta. The vector x has been transformed to the vector y by an angle theta. Can I write down a formula for the transformation that sends x to the vector y? Okay. Now you know this horizontal vertical components. If you want, you can use Pythagoras theorem. A right triangle is okay. What I have is x1 is the horizontal component, that's cos alpha. X2 is sin alpha. Yes. There is an R coming. Otherwise, we can write down a similar formula for y. Y1 is R cos alpha plus theta, and y2 has a similar formula. Let me write down this first. Okay, let me write y2 similarly. Y2 is r sin alpha plus theta. So this is r cos A cos B, r cos alpha cos theta minus r sin alpha sin theta. Y2 for me is r sin alpha sin theta sin A cos B plus cos alpha sin theta. Okay. So this is r cos alpha, go back to this. This was x1 cos theta minus x2 sin theta. That's my y2. Y1 rather. Y2 is on the other hand r sin alpha, that is x2. So let me write this first, r cos alpha. X1 sin theta plus x2 cos theta. X2 is r sin alpha into cos theta. So I have these two expressions for y1 and y2, again horizontal vertical components. Then let me write y as a column vector this time. Let me write y as a column vector. Then this y I know is y1 is x1 cos alpha minus x2, x1 cos theta minus x2 sin theta. So let me write just the coefficients, cos theta minus sin theta, this into x1 comma x2. I will write that also as a column vector. So I am now writing a matrix equation, something like Ax equal to B, B equal to Y equal to Ax. y2 is what I need to write next. X1 sine theta, this is cos theta. So I have written y equals a theta x. This matrix, the entries depend on theta. So that's a theta x. I have written y as a theta x. So I, this is the transformation formula. If you give me x, I substitute into this, I get y. Of course, I must know theta. I must know the angle of rotation. Now look at a theta. Let me now use this a theta to define t from R2 to R2 by the formula t of x equals a theta x. I am defining t of x, that is a transformation is a theta x, rotation rotates x to y. Then use matrix multiplication to conclude that this is a linear transformation. Okay, this t is linear. T is linear and it is the rotation map. T is the rotation map or the rotation transformation. Okay. So these two examples come from geometry. Let us also look at some other examples coming really from geometry, but this time we may have to look at higher dimensions. That is my fifth example. Let me look at t from Rm to Rn. Let me take the case when m is greater than or equal to n. I will define t x1, x2, etc., xm. M is greater than or equal to n, that is, n is less than or equal to m. So the number of coordinates on the this on this right hand side, I have a vector which has less than m coordinates. There is a natural definition x1, x2, etc., xn. Okay. X is in Rm. So what I have dropped is what I have done is to drop the coordinates from n plus 1 to m. Okay, this is called a natural projection. T is called a natural projection on Rm. Now you can verify that this T is linear. These are some of the simplest examples of linear transformations. This T is linear. Let us look at the usual projections, projections that we encounter in engineering drawing, for instance. T from R3 to R3 defined by T of x1, x2, x3. Yes, let me say it is x1, x2, 0, x1, x2, 0. These will be called projection operators. T is called a projection operator on R3. We will reserve the word operator when the vector spaces V and W are the same. If V is equal to W, then a linear transformation will be in particular called a linear operator. So this is an operator, it is called a projection operator. You see that any point on the plane, any point in 3 space is dropped onto the horizontal plane, the plane, let us say xy plane. Any point in the xyz plane, the z coordinate is 0. So we are looking at the projection of any point in 3 space on the so-called xy plane. That is the projection operator. This is just one of those examples. I have another several other examples. For instance, t of x1, x2, x3 could be x1, 0, x3 or x1, 0, 0 on the x-axis, etc. All these are called projection operators. Let us look at other example. Let us take this time t from Rm to Rn with m less than n. It can be equal also. The definition is as follows. This will be x1, x2, etc. xm. If it is strictly less than n, the other coordinates are taken to be 0. So these are n minus m components. M is less than or equal to n. So this may not be there, then it will reduce to the natural projections, but otherwise there are certain coordinates which are 0. Now this is not an operator, this is what is called as natural inclusion. Again t is linear, it is called a natural inclusion. Called a natural inclusion. In particular, this allows us to think of Rm as sitting inside Rn. If n is greater than m, you can think of Rm as sitting inside Rn. So this is natural inclusion. This is another example of a linear transformation. Let us look at other examples. Let us take one from the space of matrices let us say T from R m cross n, the set of all the vector space, real vector space of m by n matrices, to the real vector space of n by m matrices defined by T of A equals A transpose, T of A equal to A transpose. This A transpose has been defined earlier. If A is equal to Aij, then A transpose is Aji. And so if A is m cross n, then A transpose is n cross m. This is linear, that is because we need to verify T of x plus y equals Tx plus Ty. Let us look at T of A plus B. T of A plus B by definition is the transpose of A plus B, but the transpose can be verified to satisfy this formula, A transpose plus B transpose. Okay, this is a easy consequence of addition. A transpose plus B transpose, A transpose is T of A, B transpose is T of B. So this is additive. T of A plus B is T of A plus T of B. T of alpha times A is T of its alpha A transpose. Alpha A is multiplying alpha to each component of each term of the matrix A. So that can be taken outside. It is alpha A transpose. Remember, it is a real case. If it is a complex case, you must take alpha bar outside. Alpha A transpose, that is alpha T of A. So T is linear, we have verified. So this one comes from transformation between vector spaces of matrices. Let us look at example from differential calculus. Let us take T from C prime 0, 1. I usually say this is a complex valued space of complex valued continuous functions on the interval 0, 1, C0, 1. C prime 0, 1 space of complex valued continuous functions on 0, 1 with the property that the first derivative is continuous. I will consider this as a real space. T from C1, 0, 1 to C0, 1. Again real space. the mapping is T of a function f is f prime, its derivative function. T of f is f prime, the derivative function. T of sine theta is cos theta. F comes from C101. First of all, this is well defined because T of f is f prime. If f is in C101, does f prime belong to C01? That is the case because of the definition of C101. F prime is the first derivative, that must be continuous. So this f prime belongs to this. So this is well defined. This is a function. To verify that this is linear comes from differential calculus. D by dt of f plus g is df by dt plus dg by dt. D by dt of alpha times f is alpha df by dt. So this t is linear. This is called the differential operator. This t is called the differential operator. Okay. See, it is not just the superficial connection to differential calculus. What we will see is that later, when maybe in the next lecture, we will discuss the notion of a range space of a linear transformation, null space of a linear transformation. There you will see that the null space of a linear transformation, when T is a differential operator, especially coming from constant coefficient, that is, it is a differential operator with constant coefficients, then the null space is precisely the set spanned by the solutions which are called the so called complementary functions of the differential equation. Okay, so this connection is not just superficial. Okay, this will be made clear later. So this is called the differential operator coming from differential calculus, one from integral calculus, and probably I will stop this list. The last example is 10. Let us say I have T from C01. Again, for the sake of simplicity, I will take this to be the real space of continuous functions on 01 to R. This time the domain vector space is one dimensional, it is just R. T defined by T of f is integral 0 to 1 f of t dt. T of f is integral 0 to 1 f dt, the Riemann integration. Now we know that this is well defined again because from integral calculus we know that every continuous function is Riemann integrable. So the right hand side is well defined and you can verify easily that this is linear transformation, that is integral for two functions f and g that are continuous, integral 0 to 1 f of t plus g of t dt is equal to integral 0 to 1 ft dt plus integral 0 to 1 gt dt, t of f plus g equals tf plus tg, t of alpha f is alpha times 0 to 1 ft dt, so that is alpha t of f rather. So this is linear, this is called an integral operator. I will simply say integral transformation. This is again a linear transformation. Okay. Okay, probably one final example which sort of summarizes several of the previous examples, not all of them. I'll state that as example 11. Let me say T is from Rn to Rm is defined by, so I have T of x equals ax, where I am given an m cross n real matrix A. I am given an m cross n real matrix A. Through this matrix I am defining a transformation. This transformation is between Rn and Rm. It is from Rn to Rm defined by this equation Tx equal to Ax. This is matrix multiplication. You see that if A is m cross n, then Ax is 1 cross m cross n, m cross 1. Okay, that is a vector in Rm. So this is well defined. Most of the examples that we have discussed previously, zero transformation, identity transformation, the second example, the third example, reflection, the fourth example, rotation, natural projection, natural inclusion, projection operator, all these are particular cases of this for different choices of A. This T is linear, which follows by matrix multiplication. This is linear, okay. This sort of summarizes all those examples. Now, what is also true, which is the most interesting part of linear algebra, is that a certain converse is true. That is, if I have a linear transformation between finite dimensional vector spaces, then there is a matrix which has the property that the transformation T satisfies this equation for that matrix, okay. If I have a linear transformation between finite dimensional vector spaces, then there is a matrix A. We can construct a matrix A such that this holds for the linear transformation T that we started with, okay. So let me just say that a certain converse is true and this holds for finite dimensional vector spaces, okay. So this list should probably convince you that linear transformations are indeed important objects. Before I proceed to the certain simple properties, let me also consider this notion of what is linear. Sometimes is not really the linearity that we would like to have, as illustrated here. That is, I want to give example 12, which is not really an example. Let's look at T from R to R, defined by T of x equals x plus 1. Okay, T of x is x plus 1. The translation. Now we can plot this on R2, that is, you can call this as y, then I have y equals x plus 1. Now this is a straight line not passing through the origin, okay. You can verify that this T is not linear. You can verify that this T is not linear in spite of the fact that intuitively in R2 y equals x plus 1 is a line, okay. So if you have a formula representing a line in R2, this does not necessarily correspond to a linear transformation. This is just a simple point I wanted to illustrate, okay. Any transformation that transforms a line to a line is not necessarily a linear transformation, is what I wanted to emphasize, okay. So this is not a linear transformation. You can verify by simple examples that this T is not linear. So anything that looks like linear is not necessarily linear. On the other hand, if it is a straight line passing through the origin, then this will be a linear transformation, okay. Let us now look at some simple properties, okay. First property is the following. So let me write down this theorem. T from V to W is linear, then I have the following properties. Property 1, 0 must be mapped to 0. This is the first property. For instance, you could use this property in that last example. T of x equal to x plus 1, T of 0 is not 0, so that is not linear. T of equal to 0 equals 0. Property 2. We know that T of u plus v is T u plus T v. This holds for u minus v also. T of u minus v is T of u minus T of v. And property 3, T of u plus v equals T u plus T v. This can be extended to a finite sum. T of alpha 1 u 1 plus alpha 2 u 2. Etc. Let's say alpha k u k. This is equal to alpha 1 t of u 1 plus alpha 2 t of u 2 plus etc. alpha k t u k. This additivity property, that's condition one that a linear transformation must satisfy, can be extended to finitely many terms, in fact linear combinations. That is, here these coefficients alpha k are in R, u1, u2, etc., uk, they come from V. Let us quickly verify that these properties hold. So, I want to discuss the proof very quickly. Now, look at the first part. I will call u as t of 0, then u is t of 0 plus 0. T is linear, so t of 0 plus 0 is t 0 plus t 0. I am calling this as u. So, I have u equals u plus u. Then from the first simple property of vector spaces, it follows that u is 0. That is, t of 0 is 0. That is the first property. Property 2, t of u minus v. By definition, this is t of u plus minus 1 times v. Minus v is minus 1 into v. T is linear, so t of x plus y. So that is t of u plus, the constant is outside, t of v. Minus 1 t of v, that is happening in w. So this is t u minus t v. That is property 2. Property 3, t of alpha 1 u 1 plus alpha 2 u 2 etc. plus alpha k u k. I will keep this as a vector, maybe I will call it w. Then this is t of alpha 1 u 1 plus w. I know that this is alpha 1 t of u 1 plus t of w. Then keep this as it is, alpha 1 t of u 1 plus t of w, formula for w, t of alpha 2 u 2 plus etc. plus alpha k u k. I again have, I will keep this as it is, the rest of them I will call it w 1 and proceed. Alpha 1 t of u 1 plus alpha 2 t of u 2 plus t of w 1, where w 1 is alpha 3 u 3 plus etc. plus alpha k u k, proceed by induction etc. This is alpha 1 t u 1 etc. plus alpha k t u k. Okay, so really simple property, just making use of linearity, definition of linearity. Okay, a little more non-trivial properties of a linear transformation we will discuss next. To motivate this property, maybe I will give an example, start with an example. Let us look at the function sin x and cos x. These are functions from R to R, real valued functions of the real variable x. These functions have the property that sin x equal to cos x at infinitely many points. All those points starting from pi by 4 if you want, and then you add 2 pi. So there are infinitely many points x for which sin x equal to cos x. Okay. For a linear transformation, this kind of a thing will not be true. For a linear transformation, if you have two linear, so I have two really two functions, sin x and cos x, which coincide at infinitely many points. But if you have two transformations t1 and t2 that coincide at all those basis elements, then they must be the same linear transformation. Okay, this is one important property which separates a linear transformation from a general function. Let me make this clear. Let V be a finite dimensional vector space and T1 comma T2 from V to W be linear transformations. Sometimes I will also call them maps. These are functions. So I have T1 and T2 linear maps from V into W. No word about W. V is finite dimensional. Suppose that I have a basis B. Let us say U1, U2, etcetera, UN. Let this be a basis for V. So, see, V is finite dimensional. There is a basis consisting of finite elements, finitely many elements. I am listing that basis. Suppose T1 and T2 satisfy the following equation. If T1 of UI equals T2 of UI for all I, 1 less than or equal to I less than or equal to N. That is, the transformations T1 and T2 coincide for the basis vectors. The transformations T1 and T2 coincide for the basis vectors. Then we can show that T1 is equal to T2. Then T1 is equal to T2. So now contrast this statement with the statement that I made to motivate this theorem. Sin x and cos x, they are equal at infinitely many points, but as functions they are not equal. Okay. Remember that T1 is equal to T2 means as functions these two are equal, that is T1 of x equals T2 of x for all x in V. As functions these two are equal, they are one and the same. One can also make the following informal statement from this theorem. A linear transformation is completely determined by its action on any basis, where I am assuming that the domain space is finite dimensional. A linear transformation is completely determined by its action on any of the basis of the domain space. Okay, let's prove this quickly. I want to say that T1 is equal to T2, so I'll prove that T1 of x equals T2 of x for all x. Let x belong to V. Okay, then I have a basis explicitly given, script B. So I can write x as alpha 1 u1 plus alpha 2 u2 plus etcetera alpha n un. Okay. Let me now look at T1 of x. T1 of x is T1 of this representation alpha 1 u1 plus alpha 2 u2 etcetera plus alpha n un. T1 is linear. So this is alpha 1 t1 u1 plus alpha 2 t1 u2 plus etcetera alpha n t1 un. Now I will make use of the fact that t1 u1 is equal to t2 u1. T1 U2 is equal to T2 U2 etcetera. That is what is given. T1 and T2 coincide for the basis vectors. So this is alpha 1 T2 U1 plus alpha 2 T2 U2 plus etcetera plus alpha n T2 UN. Again use the fact T2 is linear to rewrite this as T2 of alpha 1 U1 plus alpha 2 U2 plus etcetera plus alpha n UN. But this is the x that we started with. So this is T2 of x. So what we have shown is that T1 of x is equal to T2 of x for all x in V. And so T1 is equal to T2. Okay. Let me look at a numerical example. To illustrate this result, I want to give an example. Let T from R3 to R2 be such that T of the first basis vector is this, T of the second basis vector I am in R3 to R2. So let's say minus 1, 0, 0, 1, 0. Let's say this is 1, 1, and T of 0, 0, 1. These three equations define T uniquely. These three formulas define T uniquely. What is the general formula for T of x? I can write down, because any x can be written as a linear combination of these. Okay, so let's do that quickly. Let's take x in R3, then x is I am following this notation consistently, x1, x2, x3. I can write this as x1 into, so okay, see, in our notation this is e1, this is e2, this is e3, the standard basis vector. So this is x1 e1 plus x2 e2 plus x3 e3. Any x is a linear combination of these. The coefficients x1, x2, x3 are given by the components of x. I want T of x. That is the question: what is the general formula for T of x given x? So T of x by definition is x1 T of e1, x2 T of e2 plus x3 T of e3. Just plug in these values, you get the formula for T of x. So T of e1 is minus 1, 0, x1 into minus 1, 0 plus x2 into 1, 1 plus x3 into 0, 1. So you get a formula in terms of x. This is minus x1 plus x2, second coordinate x2 plus x3. So this is T of x, minus x1 plus x2, x2 plus x3. Okay, this is a general formula. If you know x, you just plug in here, you get T of x. So the action of a linear transformation on a basis, that is enough to determine the linear transformation completely. Okay, let's also ask this question. The answer will be given in the next. This is a question. I have let's say a basis V U1, U2, etc., UN. As before, this is a basis of V. I am given a set of vectors, not necessarily a basis, of W. Let us call them W1, W2, etc., WN. This is just a subset, not necessarily a basis, be a subset of W. I have a basis for V and just a subset of W. The question is, does there exist a linear transformation, a linear map T from V to W that takes the corresponding elements to the corresponding UI to the corresponding WI, that is map such that T of UI is equals WI. UI goes to WI. Does there exist a linear map T from V to W such that this condition is satisfied? Okay. For this to be satisfied, do we need conditions on W1, etc., WN? Okay. If there exists a linear transformation, is the transformation unique? We will answer these questions in the next lecture. Let's stop.